Thank you. Welcome to the Council on Foreign Relations Local Journalists webinar. Today, we are going to be discussing misinformation and trust in media with our speakers, Daniel Acosta-Ramos and Joy Mayer, and Carla Anne Robbins. I'm Irina Faskanis, Vice President of the National Program and Outreach at CFR. This webinar is part of CFR's Local Journalist Initiative, created to help you connect the local issues you cover in your communities to global dynamics. Our programming puts you in touch with CFR resources and expertise on issues of international importance and provides a forum for sharing best practices. So thank you all for being with us. I want to remind you that this webinar is on the record and we will circulate the video and transcript and other resources after the fact. And we'll also post it on our website, cfr.org/localjournalists. We've shared out full bios prior to this webinar. So I'm just going to give you a few highlights of our distinguished panel. Daniel Acosta-Ramos is an investigative researcher at First Draft News. His work includes researching mis and disinformation on Latinx and Spanish-speaking communities in the U.S. Originally from Venezuela, Mr. Acosta-Ramos has previously worked on projects to monitor social unrest in his home country. And prior to First Draft News, he worked as a security analyst for Oxy. Joy Mayer is the director of Trusting News, a research and training project that empowers journalists to demonstrate credibility and earn trust. She is also an adjunct faculty member at the Poynter Institute. Prior to Trusting News, she spent 20 years working in newsrooms and teaching, including at the Missouri School of Journalism. And Carla Anne Robbins is an adjunct senior fellow at CFR. She is faculty director of the Master of International Affairs program and clinical professor of National Security Studies at Baruch College's Marx School of Public and International Affairs. And previously, she was deputy editorial page editor at the New York Times and chief diplomatic correspondent at the Wall Street Journal. So welcome to all of you. Thank you for being with us. I'm going to turn the conversation now over to Carla to have the exchange amongst the three of you, and then we'll turn to all of you for your questions and comments. Carla, over to you.
Thank you so much, Irina, and it's great to see you as always. And thank you so much, Daniel and Joy, if I may. And thank you so much for everybody for joining us. It's always a delight to talk to our colleagues in such an incredible time in journalism and such an incredibly challenging time in local journalism in particular. So thank you guys for joining us. I know you get a lot of questions for Joy and Daniel. So I'm gonna start the prerogative of the moderator because I've got my questions too. So Daniel, I'm gonna start with you. In 2016, when I started writing about misinformation, the focus was all on one issue area, the US elections, and one malign actor, the Russians and their amplifiers. So today's ecosystem, which is a nice way of basically saying swamp, is far more complex and a hell of a lot scarier. And the mistrust in the press is a hell of a lot more profound. So can you describe right now what are some of the main issues, it's a lot more than the election, that are drawing the most misinformation? And who are the actors? It's not just the Russians. So who do we got to worry about out there? It's a scary place.
It is indeed a scary place. And first, just thank you for the invitation. It's an honor to be with y'all. And just to answer your question, the ecosystem, which is a word that I use a lot, the ecosystem of misinformation and misinformation landscape, it's vastly diverse. And as you said, it's not only the Russians, it's not only the Venezuelan but army or the Turkey marketing company. We have a lot of misinformation growing out and about in American, in US-based Facebook pages, in WhatsApp groups, in Telegram channels. So the misinformation landscape, as we kind of were introduced to it in 2016, is vastly different. And the themes and topics are just basically infinite. There is a strong feeling, there is a strong base of misinformation spreaders that they take on politics, the big lie, and other, you know, US policy related issues. But the big theme that we're seeing now is health misinformation. And health misinformation goes beyond just the vaccine or the Pfizer shot or the Johnson & Johnson shot. It goes to the safety or things that we take for granted, such as the MMR vaccine and other medical advancements that we had for a very long time. And this new wave of health misinformation, it's coming from people, from influencers, from content creators that are not labeled, they're not identified as misinformation spreaders. They might be a wellness instructor, a yoga teacher, or any other popular, seemingly inoffensive content creator that is actually spreading misinformation. So this swamp, as you told it, is completely different than in 2016. And it's something that we researchers and journalists and local journalists have to handle with, is that yes, misinformation has a little bit of a Russian bot operative and that kind of stuff. But most of the content that we're seeing in our Facebook feed, in our Instagram posts, in our WhatsApp groups, actually comes from people just like you and me that got something and shared it accidentally because it generated a strong emotional reaction.
So are these real people? I mean, because of course in 2016, they look like real people, but then we found out they actually weren't real people. They were bots, or they were people sitting in St. Petersburg who were sharing things. And a lot of the things you're talking about are also being amplified if you go on RT, you know, or on the Russian sites or on other sites. You see that sort of vaccine misinformation is also being put out because it goes to it creates fundamental mistrust in our institutions. But those are real yoga instructors pushing these things out. Why are they doing it? They seem so healthy.
Without no doubt, I want to reiterate this. There is, you know, some bad actors placed in foreign countries, Russia, Turkey, Venezuela, many others. But what we're seeing day to day is that those yoga instructors that are real people, that and this is a confession I have to make. I was actually following one of those misinformation spreaders in my feed. So once in some point of my life, I actually liked what the yoga teacher had to say, and I'm following him. And now I have a active vaccine activist spreading misinformation in my personal feed. And this is how misinformation, you know, basically spreads to everybody. It's not a problem of the people that is highly educated or working class. No, it will affect us all because it is, you know, everywhere. And yes, there are real people. Yes, there are yoga instructors, wellness, stores, even doctors. And whether determine, what is their motive, it's really, really hard. There are a few things that we, you know, suspect. First, there is a financial incentive for misinformation spreaders. If you have a big YouTube audience, or if you have a big Facebook audience, or you have a big Telegram audience, you can monetize that through merchandising, through monetization and views. And there's even people that will use features, just as the super chat, that will let you in YouTube donate directly to the content creator live while they're broadcasting. So one big part of it is that it's a financial incentive for people that express misinformation, because sadly it's popular. And there's other people that actually believe in those things that we might consider discredited or, you know, anti-science. So I think those two things, this basically like cult mentality and a financial incentive, are two powerful reasons for why people create misinformation. But the other side of the coin is that people share misinformation. Regular people, just like you and me, share misinformation because we receive this almost apocalyptical message that triggers an emotional reaction in ourselves. And then we send it to our friends and family, to my dad, to my uncle, because I'm worried about this situation. And almost unconsciously, we are part of this gigantic misinformation ecosystem.
So I'm going to come back to you and talk about how we deal with this as reporters in a minute, but I want to go to Joy. So Joy, in 2017, the national media had something of a reckoning about how we had blown it in covering the campaign. You know, everyone was chasing after Hillary's emails the way six-year-olds all chase after a soccer ball, which was, once again, too benign a description of how we blew it. But even now, there's still a tendency to blame others for the lack of trust in the press. It's the trolls, it's Donald Trump, both of whom actually deserve an enormous amount of blame for the lack of trust. But, you know, the mission of trusting news is, you say you identify things news audiences don't understand about how journalism works and use engagement and transparency strategies to rebuild trust. How much, what are the sources of this mistrust? How much of it is due to misinformation, and how much of it is due to, how much of it is our responsibility? How much of it is more profound things going on in our society? Because we got to figure out what the problem is before we can figure out how to fix it.
Yeah, it's a, I think that it's really important to understand the complexity of the situation. And in even a concept like misinformation can mean so many different things. Like a yoga teacher sharing in good faith something that's not accurate about how careful we need to be about what we put in our bodies, and maybe the vaccine's not safe or whatever. Like that's misinformation. And especially for local journalists, that is something they're hearing, and that is something their audience is hearing and genuinely struggling with how to process. That's why when we're talking about local journalism specifically, you know, it's a different landscape if you're covering, if your job is to cover Russian influence in the election versus what is my community hearing that is preventing them from making well-informed decisions about our shared democracy, our shared community, their family safety, whatever it is. And so, you know, when it comes to really processing different sources of information, we really preach a transparency, I mean, an empathy around the difficulty of being a news consumer, because it is really tough sometimes to tell what is a legit news source, where information's coming from. I don't know about you guys, but I get a lot of Facebook messages from people in my own networks because I'm like the journalist people know, right? And they'll say, Joy, to help me figure out, is this source legit? And sometimes it's actually not that easy to tell if the source is legit. And most people are not news junkies. They don't spend a lot of time trying to figure out where they get their news. They don't think about it that much. They don't give money to any news. They have a casual relationship with information sources. And so for them to figure out which ones are ethical, responsible, well-sourced, well-intentioned, staffed by professionals, it's actually complicated. And so that casual relationship also means they don't spend that much time wondering how news works. They genuinely don't know that the reason we spent so much time in the story on this side of the story and had only one sentence from this other side of the story is because that's all we could get. Not that we have an agenda that means that we purposefully left most of their side of the story out, right? People don't know that. And there's no reason they should know it, because we can wish that they knew it, but they don't know it because we don't explain ourselves. So there are a lot of reasons that people don't trust the news. Some of it's institutional, you know, people don't trust the government and the military and banks as much as, and religion as much as they, higher education, you know, trust is falling in institutions all over the place. But when it comes to what local journalists can do, we really start by figuring out what kind of feedback are you getting about what people do and don't understand about your own work and the information landscape in your community, and how can you improve that?
So the polling, though, suggests that certainly, or the most recent polling, which is the 2019 Knight Gallup polling, suggests that people trust local news more than they trust bad people like me in national news, particularly the hated New York Times. But they still trust local news a lot less than they trust even local government. Is it just a general loss of faith in institutions? Is that what we're grappling with? Or is it, you know, because social media and there's just a cacophony there and the press is seen as just one more extension of, people don't even distinguish it, you know, everybody's got their own truth and you're, I mean, is that what's really going on here? I mean, what is it that we're really up against that makes people so fundamentally mistrust the press, and particularly the local press, which people really used to see as a fundamentally really trustworthy institution?
It's true that people trust local news more, and it's true that trust in local news is declining and that people used to trust it. They also used to trust just network news. You know, I think that the national conversation and messaging around journalists as enemies of the people and the fake news, like that is absolutely trickling down. You know, when I sit down with weekly newspaper publishers in Texas who've served their same communities for decades, their relationship with the people they serve has changed because the messages that people are receiving about the role of journalism in society, the perceived agenda of journalists, who journalists even are, it definitely has an impact up and down the food chain of journalism. I think the problem of it just cannot be overstated how complicated it is to try to sift through information and the barrage of information that's constantly coming at us and how many choices people have, that we there is 100% a huge increase in irresponsible messages coming at people. And so, you know, one thing I think is really important to remember is that we don't deserve automatic credit just because we have the title of journalist. There are a lot of things done in the name of journalism that I think are irresponsible or unethical or sensational or not a reputable place I would point people, right? So I'm not here to defend the whole industry of journalism. I'm here to say, if you do mission-driven, responsible, ethical, professional journalism, you need to explain to people what sets you apart from the rest. And that's not an automatic thing. The fact that I work at this news brand that maybe they haven't even heard of or haven't actually really consumed, or maybe they always get me confused with my less responsible competitors, or it is complicated to be a news consumer. There are people who have beefs or assumptions or really justified perceptions of news organizations that has caused them to have lower trust. But I also think it's important to keep in mind that a lot of people have very casual relationships and have been misled by information enough times that they kind of just are over it and don't trust anyone.
So I want to come back to you about the services you provide and how you can help people deal with this. And a lot of this is self-awareness, not just, you know, what you're going to be pushing out, but some of it is just self-awareness about exactly what you said, which is we can't take it for granted anymore. I mean, but let's talk to Daniel, and I'm just going to ask if we can share, you know, something from your pretty fab website. Thanks so much, Audrey, for doing that. So, Daniel, can you talk a little bit about, you know, the challenge here, which is as much as we can't automatically earn, you know, rely on trust, part of our job actually is to translate, to debunk. You know, people don't have the time to do this. And then one of the reasons people call Joy is because they do sort of expect you to sort out, you know, the BS from the not BS. And so how do we as reporters, and particularly as local reporters that don't have infinite resources, how do we get ahead of the wave? It's a hell of a lot harder to debunk something when it's really fixed in people's minds. How do you get ahead of a story? And one of the things that you guys do there is raise the alert when something is bubbling up. So certainly they can go to your Vaccine Insights Hub and warn people about trending stories, about, you know, something on YouTube which says that vaccines are actually abortion drugs or something like that. But how do you get ahead of it, ahead of the wave just as it's coming, rather than letting it get really fixed in people's minds?
I think the secret to that recipe, and which actually lies in local journalists, is that when we detect a new narrative, a new thing that is bubbling, as you said, a new thing that we catch in the, you know, yoga teacher's Instagram feed or in Telegram or in the dark places on the internet, is that it's better to pre-bunk than debunk. Preemptively alert your community of the things you may see or might explode, you know, in a few days or in a few weeks. When we structure information as a pre-bunk before actually explodes, the community already knows what is BS and what is not, who is the actor involved, which are the claims, and which is the actual fact. So I think pre-bunking is an extremely effective tool, especially for local journalists, because most of the narratives we catch, most of the perpetual false claims that we detect originate in local groups, originate in local communities, in, you know, this Newark Parks and Recreations Facebook group, or in this Navajo Nation meeting place and Facebook, or in Instagram. And the, from then, from that local place, it gets, you know, to the point in which is shared by this national voice of misinformation or those really important misinformation spreaders in a national level. But it does originate locally. And if we can target misinformation at a local level preemptively early, the effect it will have after it goes mainstream, let's call it that way, it will be way less. So I think, and this is something that we preach at First Draft a lot, that pre-banking is absolutely necessary. Of course, we have to be responsible with something that we call the tipping point. It's not exact science. It's more of an art. If you do it too early, you pose the risk of informing, you know, something completely unnecessary to your community. But if you do it too late, it's already in their brains and they will have some of a confirmation bias. So it's definitely a challenge, but I think local communities, local journalists, community newspapers have a great advantage that they know their community, they know what they're talking about. So I will say that that's the way, the place to start.
So tell me a little bit more about what's a pre-bunk story for a local journalist. I mean, I'm looking right now on my screen very closely because I've got many things going on my screen, including my questions for you guys. So emerging narratives, okay. Guidance around hugging in the UK sparks claims that undermine trust in COVID-19 vaccine. Or tourism agencies in time. Okay. I mean, tell me something that, I mean, hugging would be a good little story, but I thought the abortion one on YouTube was a particularly worrisome one because abortion is such an emotional issue. How do you decide, I mean, that's on YouTube. You guys found that on YouTube. How do you decide, and I understand that's art more than science, that it's bubbling up enough that it's worth raising rather than running the danger that you're going to be an amplifier by writing about it? And B, how do you write about it in a way that, you know, that you actually can debunk it, you know, that is persuasive?
Well, the first one is when we see claims or narratives in different platforms, it's a good sign that the tipping point is getting closer.
When it's cross-fertilizing.
Exactly. Okay. If we see the same thing on the dark, you know, sides of the internet, and then we immediately see it on Facebook or in Twitter, probably it's time to alert community-based organizations, journalists, local journalists, you know, from that claim. And the other part of the question is, how do we make it, you know, shareable? I love a good explainer. And I think people love it too. Quick format, beautifully done, lots of infographics that will explain in an easy way, not to say whatever the yoga teacher said, and the yoga teachers will hate me after this panel, but whatever the yoga teacher said is false. Instead of saying that, just explain the circumstances and the facts without mentioning the yoga teacher. Don't give the stage to the misinformation spreader. If you can't, do not repeat the lie, just state the facts and alert your community. You might be seeing some claims that say that, you know, vaccine causes abortion, or you can shed the spike protein. That is not true. Here's the data, here's a trusted voice, here's that. And something, and I think this is particularly important for vaccines and particularly important for local journalists, is that you need to find a local voice that, you know, it's an expert about this. For instance, I'm based in Houston, Texas, and we have Dr. Hoetz, which is this fantastic scientist that knows a lot about vaccines and how they work. I rather use Dr. Hoetz instead of Dr. Fauci, because people actually know this guy here in Houston. And we need to find these local voices that will have some sort of relationship with the communities we're serving on. And that, I think, will not solve, but it will ease one of the untrustworthiness that people have through media, and that's the coast elitism or the New York centrism or the Washington centrism. And I think, you know, it's just a little bit of help to fight, you know, both misinformation and trust in your outlets.
Great. Great. Okay, that is it. So before I ask or to take down the shared screen, I did want to say, so one of the services you can provide is, and that your website can provide, is you guys can do the digging and raise the alarm when things are beginning to cross-fertilize, when you think that they're bubbling up to that. That's one of the jobs that you do in First Draft. And so people can go to your website and see what's bubbling up. But what you're saying is then they do the reporting in their local community to where the credibility is. That's basically the advice you're giving.
Correct. And we also have a tons of resources, especially when it comes with vaccines, because we acknowledge that until this point, probably if you were a reporter in the community level, you didn't cover vaccinations. You didn't cover a rollout of a new technology that took, you know, thousands of millions of dollars to develop. And we created a long format of several trainings for the vaccine. It's available in the Vaccine Hub, and it's a fantastic resource that is available in different languages. So for local journalists that serve immigrant communities, and for local journalists that serve, you know, people that may not speak English, it's available in French, in Spanish, in Hindi, in some other languages. So I highly recommend that. Not just the research that we do, but the training and media resource that we have as well.
That's great. Thank you so much. So we're going to go to Joy now, and who also has a fabulous website. And I'm equally blown away by your website and all the advice and services you two provide for journalists. So if we can put up your website, which is great. This is we were talking before that a lot of this is transparency and self-awareness. So can you talk, you know, you've got this series of tips here, people can sign up for your newsletter, but, you know, talk to me about your theory of the case about what journalists have to do to A, develop self-awareness, and B, to reach out to the community to deal with this wave of misinformation and the lack of trust.
Yeah. I mean, journalists like to think that we can overwhelm people with facts and that will take care of the situation. So here is the, you know, 27 point list of reasons why you can trust the vaccine is not going to have nearly as much effect as, to Daniel's point, a local doctor you trust saying, guys, it's really okay. Your family's going to be okay. Go ahead and do this. And, you know, to get researching for a second, we talk about the distinction between cognitive trust, which is like the brainy trust, and affective trust, which is, I feel like you're on my side. I feel connected to you. I think I can trust you. You're one of the good guys. And so really for a local journalist, we talk a lot about what basic things do people not understand about you and what is your counter narrative? So if, for example, if you get a lot of complaints on your Facebook feed of people saying, why are you posting this story on Facebook when I can't read it because there's a paywall? You should only post it if it's free. Well, have you explained why you need revenue from your community, how much of your budget that costs, how many local staff positions that get money from that, you know, how little the money is, how advertising dollars work, whatever it is. Do you have a counter narrative about why you charge for news and why that's important? So often we don't take time to explain it. We just think, gosh, people think we're greedy. Like, that's dumb. They don't know what they're talking about. And so if you want to be trusted to provide credible information, they need to understand who you are. You don't get automatic trust. And so for us, we'll take something like, oh, people are complaining about paywall. People complain about bias in Associated Press stories. People complain about, you know, their perceptions of like national and world news. And they think your local TV station is so biased, but really what they're complaining about is the CNN feed that runs on your website or whatever it is. So we just talk a lot about understanding what do people actually think of you and what do they not know? And what are you actually doing to clear that up? Or are you just wishing that they understood? So like Daniel, we, I think those of us who work in sort of the journalism support space are like both really grateful when we get journalist attention. Thank you to those of you showing up today. And like, hey, you guys, this is free. We can help you. This, so please, there are a lot of resources here that can help you if you're trying to figure out how to do this.
So I thought, you know, you've got in your COVID, you know, which is a little bit further down on this page. I mean, your number one tip, which I actually wish the US government would follow as well. I remember when I was an editorial writer and people would call me from the Obama administration and I would every once in a while lose it and say, I'm tired of doing your work. You know, why do I have to explain you? You need to explain you. But your number one tip is tell your audience that COVID-19 information might change, that it's not like, you know, this is the number one critique of them. Well, you told us masks were one thing and whatever. I mean, these
people are holding on to that mask discrepancy from, you know, 12 months ago, people are holding on to. And it's true for breaking news coverage as well. Like, if you told us there were two people who died in this shooting and now you're saying it was just one, were you hiding it from us? Do you not care about the facts? What is it? You're like, no, like, that's what the police said. And then we learned more. Like, that's how these things work, right? That's how science works. You learn more. That's how reporting works. You learn more. But people don't know that. They're not giving us automatic credit for it. And so we can accept that or we can do something to try to educate them.
So this is an interesting question about are we changing the way the basic structure of a news story? I mean, rather than putting this in a correction or putting it in a box or putting it way down in B matter, does context have to progress a lot higher up into a news story in a context of time in which people are so skeptical of we told you X and now we have to tell you Y. Are you talking about a fundamental change in the way in which we structure news stories?
Yes, I am. And we have some great research that shows that people appreciate it. We did some focus groups with TV stations that say, you know, you add a total of 20 seconds maybe to an on-air story, but explain why you're doing the story and something about a decision you made while doing the story. And people find the story and the station more credible. It's not... it's not a heavy lift, but it is 100% an update in what we think the job of journalism is. It's understanding our audience well enough to know, you know, they might assume this about us, or they might not know all of the time we spend making decisions in the newsroom. It's all invisible unless we talk about it. You know, the 30 minutes we spent, should we name this person? Which photo should we use? How big a deal is this story? How did we play a similar story last year? All of it's invisible. And yet, we pat ourselves on the back for it and feel good about it and are frustrated that we're not getting credit for it.
So I have a million more questions for you guys, but I know we already have a question in the Q&A. And so I'm gonna turn this over to Irina, who is going to invite people. But I also, I'm gonna come back because I got more questions. So Irina.
Fantastic. So now we'll go to all of you. If you can raise your hand and accept the unmute prompt and tell us who you are when I call on you. So let me just get up. I think we've got
already somebody already got in. Ricky Bevington got in first on the Q&A.
There you go. Ricky from Georgia Public Broadcasting. Thank you, Ricky, for your question. Tips for finding out about local misinformation before it goes viral. We'd have to assign a reporter to sit on next door and get invited into thousands of private Facebook groups. So who wants to take that one?
Daniel, that's sort of your biggest.
I can say next door is a hugely problematic space. And it's hugely problematic because if you're doing research like me for several different cities or several different states, you know, it's kind of impossible to get invited to, you know, 80 or 85 different communities. But it is hugely problematic. It's basically not, nobody, you can post whatever you want there and be a misinformation spreader. And basically you won't ever get kicked out or, you know, even get an alert that you're sharing misinformation. So it's a place where all misinformation, conspiracy theories and bad things live. And it's an app that most of American suburbia have installed in their phones. So I think it's a great thing that for you to be there, but just be mindful and careful that people may not need to hear another story about 5G causing cancer or something like that. And just be mindful of the bits and pieces that you grab and try to, what we do and what we find the most interesting is when we see patterns. when we see this, and I'll go again with the vaccine causing a shedding and abortions for people that are not vaccinated, because it was really strong in community based groups. We saw the pattern in one group, in another, in Facebook, in Instagram. And when we saw it in different places, we have to alert our community-based organizations and our, you know, partner journalists about this. So if you see a pattern in local Facebook groups, in Nextdoor, which is hugely problematic, in a Telegram channels, which is, I think, in an important space also to be, it might be the best, you know, the best time to alert your partners and your newsroom.
But the real question that I think Ricky is asking is one of resources, which is, you know, most local news organizations don't have the resources to sit on Nextdoor. You know, when I was at the Times, we had the resources for people to spend the time doing things like that. I don't know about Nextdoor, but that is, I'm now showing my age. But certainly, I mean, certainly people whose job was to spend all their time looking at Twitter. So what can a local news organization do that doesn't have somebody assigned to do this full time? Do you guys monitor Nextdoor as well? Are there, you know, Joy, do you know about, you know, other local sources, you know, that are news organization, local news organization pooling resources potentially to do this? You know, I mean, Patch doesn't exist anymore, but, you know, is there like a disinformation Patch resource there or something like that?
I don't know in terms of sort of collaboratives to sort of take on the work. I think what we really recommend is that the investment of time you spend listening to your community, which is basically what we're talking about, right? Monitoring community conversations. You obviously can't monitor all of them, nor should you try. And that's always been the case, that it's not worthwhile to do it all the time. But when it matters a lot, when you're trying to reach out to a specific community, you're going to listen more to what they have to say. When you're really investing in a specific topic, you're going to figure out where people are talking about that topic, right? So I do think that as part of your coverage of, if covering vaccine adoption in your community is part of your beat, you are going to look for places where people in your community are talking about vaccines. That doesn't mean, you know, it could come up in any one of thousands of Facebook groups, but there are some where it's probably more likely, right? I definitely could point to the ones in my community where it would be worthwhile for a reporter to be there. And what we're suggesting is an update on what you're listening for, not just story ideas, which reporters have always known where in their community to look for story ideas. Like, you're eavesdropping at the coffee shop. There's this one Facebook group where parents hang out and the education reporter pays attention, whatever it is. Instead of just listening for story ideas, listen for misassumptions about what you cover. Listen for people spreading misinformation, and listen for misassumptions about you and your ethics and your integrity as a news organization. And then decide, I can't address all of it, but where does it seem like it's risen to the level where this could be actually problematic, or this person talking actually has a wide audience, or this person is saying they also saw it over here. So we need to be on the record clearing that one up.
So we have another question.
Yes, from John Allison. The number of our readers who see the AP as biased is so alarming. Thanks, Joy, to you for noting that. Could you talk a little bit more? He'd like to hear more about that from others. Are you hearing the same?
So at Trusted News, actually, we are just wrapping up a project where we worked with 20-something newsrooms to interview people who lean right in their communities about what they think about local news. And as I've been checking in with each of those newsrooms to see what those interviews were like, I was talking to an editor in Missouri this morning who said she was just blown away by how many perceptions of her community newspaper were based on perceptions of her staff's selection of and placement of and headline writing for Associated Press stories. And it is frustrating and alarming, and sometimes out of local journalist control. Like, I know, I'm sure some of you work at news organizations where there's a hub somewhere that picks the AP stories and you don't even have anything to do with it. And yet your community is really basing a lot of their perception on that. I think one problem is that journalists don't see that really as part of what they're offering. They don't really take ownership over it a lot of times. And yet people do turn to you for all the information you're providing. So it is a choice in your newsroom or your news organization to say, but people need state and national and international coverage. This is We are going to get that from the Associated Press. We pay for the right to publish that. We trust them because of X, Y, and Z. There's research that shows that, that they've covered this for a long time and that they're a solid choice. We don't explain any of that. It's not part of how our local newsrooms think about what they're offering. And so we're working on strategies and have a lot of ideas about what it would look like to sort of just to have a better conversation about what role that coverage plays.
Can you explain something to me, which is why is it that people mistrust the AP? I mean, God, the AP, it's like, you know, it's like cream of wheat, for God's sake. It's like, you know, it's about as basic as you can get.
I think a lot of it is story selection. And I think there's no way to, as with so many things about perceptions of news, it's impossible to separate it from the Trump years and the perception that national journalists had nothing but criticism for President Trump and that we covered every sensational tweet and that the perception among his followers that his supporters, that he did not get credit for things that went right. I think if the media diet you're consuming is telling you that mainstream media won't give Trump credit for anything and jumps on everything, then which AP stories you select is seen as part of that bias, not only the word choice in the stories.
But is it because it says it's from the AP, or is it just anything that's national or international news in your local paper?
Well, there aren't a lot of options in most local papers.
No, that's not what I'm saying. Is the mistrust of running national and international stories, or is it the mistrust of the byline from the Associated Press?
It is the mistrust of national journalism as represented by the Associated Press, because that's the only option there.
So people would rather just have local newspapers that just covered local news?
No, they wouldn't actually. Again, most people are not thinking about this all that much. They have a sense that national news coverage is unfair and that journalists are all liberal and that there's an agenda behind all of it and that journalists are selecting stories that reinforce their worldview and purposefully hiding stories that contradict their worldview. And people are being so conditioned for what we call confirmation bias, which is if it's not coming from my worldview, if it's attempting to be neutral, it actually is not fair. It's leaning the other direction. I mean, there are a lot of factors, but fundamentally, if you read your local newspaper and spend the day watching Fox News, then what you see in your local newspaper is not going to match the national narrative you're used to. And it's going to seem as if different things are being highlighted. The tone of the story is different. And I do think it is worthwhile for journalists to have some more self-reflection around what blind spots we might have because of who we are as journalists and how that separates us from the communities we serve. That I was on this morning with a community and a newspaper's editorial page that both lean right and what that looks like. So lots of conversations to have there. But fundamentally, how local news organizations provide national news is something we need to talk more about.
Thank you.
Great. And John Allison is with the Pittsburgh Tribune. So I'm going to go next to Jeff Carr, who works at the Sentinel and is also an associate professor at the North Idaho College, which is a community college. He's often shocked by how much vitriol gets directed toward the media. His students often make claims that the media is biased. I challenge them to send me an example of this or something they consider fake news. I've had two students take me up on that offer, and both of them failed to provide a single news article. The first sent me a speech transcript from Nancy Pelosi. The other sent me a letter to the editor, a book review, and a few pieces clearly identified as an editorial or opinion. How can we combat misinformation if so few of our citizens can even recognize legitimate news sources?
I'm going to say it, media literacy. But media literacy, and I think this is pivotal, this is really important. Media literacy does not, it has to start in preschool, if possible. Not in the university, not in higher education. It has to be, and this is a great project, I think it's Washington University that's doing that in high school, for high schoolers to identify, provenance and media sources. And MediaWise has a likewise project with adolescents, with young people. And I think it's pivotal for the communities to help and to be thought in media literacy standards. Because the root of the problem is that, as Joey said, we have a casual relationship with information. We don't care. You know, most people will just grab whatever they receive in Facebook without thinking about it. And I always will remember this piece of an NPR interview in which an old lady basically said that, oh, I just hear in the OAN, One American Network, that this thing happened. And the reporter asked her, have you heard about them before? And the lady suddenly comes to the realization that she has been sharing something from a news network that she doesn't know, she has never heard about. And when she Googles it, she says, oh, they share fake news. Well, don't they all? So this relationship with the media and with terrible term that is fake news needs to be addressed through media literacy. The younger, the better. I think it's a hard multilateral, you know, conversation that we need to have, but media literacy is really important.
I just stuck in the chat. We have a Trust 101 class that we teach, and we do one specifically for educators. And as part of that, we have a collection of assignments educators can use, some developed by people in our class. So Jeff, I stuck a link to that in the chat. You know, there are a lot of assignments you can do to say, let's strip away the branding and just look at four ways that that a story was covered and see if you can guess who might have done it and analyze what the differences are. I think so we can, I guess my answer is we can wish that people understood how to vet sources of information, or we can like, you know, wish upon a star, or we can build things into our processes and our teaching that educate people about that. I am actually floored by how easy it is to not know the difference between news and opinion these days. Our industry does a terrible job at this. It starts with cable news. It's impossible to tell sometimes which talking head is an analyst or a commentator or a reporter or an anchor. Anchors share all kinds of opinions. It's complicated. But even in a newspaper story, maybe in print, it seems really obvious because something's on the opinion page that it's opinion. But you know how often that word opinion doesn't follow when it's pasted on Facebook? So somebody will see your news organization sharing something saying, our congressman needs to do this. And the word opinion isn't there. And maybe if you click through, it's little above the headline, but not in that first impression. We just do a terrible job differentiating. We need to accept that that level of media literacy is part of our job.
Thank you. We have a written question from Ali DeMarco, who's at the Daily Beacon in Tennessee. Do you have any tips for how to cover misinformation in a manner that will lower the possibility of being accused of giving a platform to that misinformation?
I think that's a great question. And again, this tipping point that we were talking about, it's hard to determine. But when it comes to local issues, I think the tipping point is lower because for the national conversations, when I see a post that has been shared 200,000 times, I know the tipping point's there, right? For a national audience. But if we are talking about a town in Tennessee, that when the online chatter has been, you know, substantiated in several groups, I think it's better to alert your community, right? Because that misinfo will grow in your community-based organizations and community-based groups. So if three or four neighbors are already talking about it, it's time to address it, especially if you live in a small town or a small city. So I'll say there's a bunch of resources in First Draft page and for sure in Joy's website as well. So it's free. I'll say it again. Please go ahead, grab, you know, there's several things you can do. There's a fantastic SMS course that you can take. It's 2 weeks, it's free, it's an OR website. You will get a text. And I think it's actually the best thing you can do, especially for older folks. I enrolled my mom and my dad because they were just getting a lot of misinfo and, you know, just sharing it on Facebook. And I was like, why? Because the media literacy again, and because it's easy to share and it's easy to forward. So get the SMS course, it's fantastic. And you will receive bits of information every day for 2 weeks. And I think after that, you will be better equipped to address misinformation, especially at the community level.
I have one other tip to share about how to make sure your motives are clear when you share information, and that's to tell people why you're sharing it. Just speak directly to them. Picture radio or TV being able to say, we know it's complicated to navigate information these days, and we want to make sure that you know something you're hearing just isn't true. And that's why we're going to go ahead and share this with you. That can work really well in that sort of informal language. It works really well in newsletters. It works really well in social. Text stories are when it can be hardest to sort of sneak in that here's why we're doing this story, but it can work with a little box. What if each time you do these stories, you had a little box with a story or an editor's note that says, we don't ever want to, contribute to the spreading of misinformation, but we're seeing this shared enough that it seems worthwhile to go ahead and let you know it's not true. There's not a lot of downside to that. And it invites people to consume something in the spirit in which it's intended.
Plus, it also creates a personal relationship between you and the reader, which I think does take away some of that angst, that sense of elitism, and one hopes will begin to create a certain measure of trust.
Yeah, and it communicates about your values, right? My goal is for people to not only learn about what you're covering, but learn about your values and integrity and goals as they're consuming your information. Just have a general sense that is just a drumbeat that you're making decisions carefully, that you have their best interests at heart, that that you have a foundation of ethics you're based on. You know, most people don't know journalists have ethics. We don't point to it. Hopefully they're on your website somewhere, but do you ever link to them and say, in accordance with our ethics policy, we made this decision? I don't know why we don't do that, but we don't.
Maybe it's a good time to start it in this day and age. So we have another written question. Nobody's raising their hand. Everybody's putting their questions in the chat. So I will continue reading. Natalie Tadera. She's the editor for The Stute, the student newspaper at Stevens Institute of Technology. I often find that while we work to serve our community of students, some of these same students don't trust us. What do you recommend in terms of transparency tactics, increased editorials to explain newsroom decisions, open forums, notes attached to content? I think, Joy, that was where you were going. So,
yeah, I think that especially for a student audience, man, I love video for that. Instagram stories, Facebook Live videos. We worked with student media at Annenberg Media at USC in California, and they did a wonderful series of sort of behind the scene videos that they did as Instagram videos and then posted them on YouTube so they could save them. But it's like, here's why we decided to cover this suicide that happened on campus when we normally wouldn't. Here is why we decided to cover this story in this particular way. It's very humanizing. To sort of introduce yourself, like, we're students too, here's where I'm from, here's what I'm studying. One thing I've learned about journalism is that it's important for this, and here's some video of the newsroom, you're welcome to stop by. Like, there's this like shroud of mystery that happens, and journalists can be so worried about, you know, we don't want to make it about us, but people don't know you. Most people have never talked to a local journalist. Pew had research last year that showed it was 21% of people said they had ever spoken to or been interviewed by a local journalist. And that number goes down if you're not rich, white, educated, and something else. So that there was another factor. But most people don't have a frame of reference. They've never met one of us, right? So whatever you can do to say, here's who we are and what we're all about, and we're not scary, stop by and ask us a question. I would really recommend you think about video, especially for the student audience.
So can I ask a question of the group, which you can either verbally or written respond to, which is, what questions and, you know, what misinformation are you seeing bubbling in your community? You know, what are you most worried about? You tuned into this for a reason. So we're going to use you as lead sources. What are you hearing the most of? Or did you just tune in because people don't like you and you want to figure out a way of getting past this? And what stories are you worrying about and hearing most of? And while we wait, and I hope somebody actually responds to that question, I'm going to ask a question about another area of misinformation. Which is, we talked about vaccines, obviously, which is a very hot topic, but the election isn't over with for a lot of people in the country. And how much is the focus of your work, both of you, your work dealing with this ongoing claim, utterly false, that, you know, that the election was stolen and that the issue isn't over with. And how can people in local communities deal with that? Because that seems to be, if you look at polling data, or the decision to toss Liz Cheney out of leadership in the GOP tomorrow, this is obviously an ongoing, you know, for a certain percentage of the population, really an ongoing trauma, and one that goes profoundly to the strength of our democracy. So Daniel, how much of that is still bubbling and how much of that is the focus of the work of your organization?
Sadly, those claims never ended. I think they were reducing presence online because many of the groups repeating the big lie repeatedly every single day were either deplatformed or banned, or you know, they had to change their behavior and migrated to darker places in the internet. But they're still there. We see it every day and it's constant. But I do believe that And it's something that we can actually measure, the amount of interaction that is getting. It's absolutely diminished if we compare it to November, December. So I do think there is a lack of interest for the general public towards that. You know, misinformation is not as popular, let's put it bluntly that way, but it's absolutely there and it's worrisome. And one of the things I'm particularly worried about is that the claims that we saw in November, they have basically evolved into something that is completely detached to reality to this point. And is often accompanied by other conspiracy theories, is often accompanied by other anti-Semitic tropes, by anti-LGBTQ propaganda and some other stuff. So it stopped being just an election issue. And now it's basically like an umbrella of misinformation tendencies that it's really hard to address, but it's there. But I do think it's not as popular or it's not as consumable as it was before.
Most people aren't news junkies and they have short attention spans. So I'm not surprised to hear Daniel say that. I think that people are kind of moving on and just doing whatever's in front of them today. When asked, they probably will still say, and polling does suggest that people still would say that their belief hasn't changed about the election. But, you know, just like we were talking about with vaccine experts, I think staying local is really important. And you know, just making sure that as local journalists, we have all of our local elected officials on the record about where they stand on this. I put in the chat today's newsletter for Trusting News is about the public radio station in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, and their efforts to continue to hold local leaders responsible for their votes and their public comments back in January. But that's, you know, that people, there are people who are never going to believe that changed it. And you have to just at some point, that the election was fair. And at some point, you just have to set that aside and keep moving.
Arena, we had some people who wanted to respond to my question. Yay.
Yes, and the chat is disabled, but you could put it in the Q&A box. Sorry about that. So Ricky Bevington wrote, I live in Georgia where Congress people and state leaders spread misinformation relentlessly. Millions of voters believe it. We simply tell people it's false, but they're already convinced. Telling people the truth is not enough. And I know that J.R. Hardman also wanted to. He's an AP with PBS Utah in Salt City. So if you want to put it in the chat, that would be fine. Or you can also email us, localjournalists@cfr.org, so we can sort of get a beat on those issues and maybe take them up in future webinars.
I would recommend having some boilerplate language that explains why you are so convinced that the election was fair. I think reminding people of the basic facts and asking, you know, if you have sources that have convinced you otherwise, you know, to a point, I still am open to hear that, I guess, partly so you can debunk it. But your goal is not to persuade people who have entrenched in a view not based on facts that they're wrong. That's not the goal. The question, of course, is then whether they're using that as a litmus test to see if you're credible in the future. And I guess I would say that it's worthwhile to engage so that you can understand where they're coming from and know what you're up against and have a chance to explain yourself.
No, but that does raise a really pretty fundamental question, which is if it is a litmus test, you're never going to I mean, they will be measuring you against it on everything else. And there's no way, I mean, you can't stand in front of a green wall and say it's orange just to, so that they'll believe you on everything else.
No, you definitely can't. And there are some people who aren't persuadable. And I think it's an open question. You know, there are some people who think if the Washington Post published it, it's probably made up. People who genuinely think they're sitting there inventing information, right? So there are people who are not persuadable. And I think the jury's still out how big a group that is, how much this particular issue has influenced that. Again, for me though, I focus on local. Like, what does that mean for how you're focused, how you're covering your community? Are people genuinely afraid that you are going to bring an agenda or a lack of respect for the facts they believe in to your coverage of the city council, of local schools, of local sports, of local arts? Like, I think the more you can sort of differentiate yourself from that, like, for sure, hold your state representatives and Congress people accountable for that. But that's not what most of us cover, frankly. Most journalists aren't covering the big lie and whether the election was fair, especially not right now. So I would say the more you can distance yourself from that and not make it your job to defend all of journalism or defend the credibility of the election, unless you're tasked with that, I would say it might be more fruitful, a better use of your time to think about what else you could be doing.
Daniel, last word, because we're almost done.
I will say, and I couldn't agree more with Jory, the communities that we serve, the conversations that we look, and it's as easy as, you know, try to see which is the most popular post on Facebook, is usually not about the election. And it's sadly usually not about the vaccine either. So I think as journalists, we're experts telling stories and experts, writing, but we have to get better at listening what our community is saying, what people is actually talking about, so we can better serve them.
Well, I want to say thank you before I turn it over to Rena. This has been an extraordinary conversation, and I want to thank you both also for the work that you're doing. Your websites are fabulous. Your trainings look wonderful. I've signed up for both of your, I'm going to be pen pals with you, at least I'm going to be on receipt. So thank you so much for what you're doing. And Rena, back to you.
Thank you, Carla, and thank you, Joy and Daniel. We will circulate to all of you the resources that were mentioned and the links. So please share them, use them and share them with your colleagues who were not part of today's conversation. This is meant to be a forum for best practices, and we hope you will take advantage of that. You can follow everybody on Twitter at Robbins Carla, Daniel's at Dan_Acosta, and Joy's at Mayor Joy. So go there. Please visit CFR.org, thinkglobalhealth.org, and foreignaffairs.com for the latest developments and analysis on international trends and events and how they're affecting the U.S. Please share suggestions for future webinars and issues that are of utmost concern to you. You can email us at localjournalists@CFR.org. And thank you all again for today's terrific conversation. We really appreciate it. Stay well, stay safe, and thank you.